one's kind of funky, isn't it? Now, let's talk about Vladimir Putin. He's apparently got form for this and may have been doing it for many years, even before the Ukraine war. But we've all seen him on the telly. We've all seen the photos. And the president of Russia, to say the least, does not look at all well. So more and more experts say there's definitely a case for saying he is now using a body double. Someone who looks just like him, but a much fitter and healthier version. And he's using this body double increasingly to project an image of a fit, healthy and dynamic president as opposed to what he actually is. So is the Vlad we are seeing all that he seems? Let's talk to research fellow at the Henry Jackson Society, Stepan Stepanenko. Good morning, Stepan.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm all right. I mean, more and more people seem to be saying, I mean, and we're talking about reputable observers of the Russian scene, say that not only is it very possible he's using a body double for pictures and publicity appearances, but actually he's got form for this dating back quite a few years, even before the Ukraine war. Where do you stand on this?
He definitely does. And it's something that's happened with Russian or Soviet leaders for decades. Stalin had body doubles, Khrushchev, Brezhnev. It's something that they all relied on at times when they didn't want to face the public or feared that there's a threat to them. And most certainly there are many more people who wish harm to Putin than good. So he has form there. But that meeting with Erdogan, although on home turf and could have been edited by the media, was very public, with a person on whom he wanted to make an impression. So it's more likely that on that case, he was there in person. Now, there's another question of how healthy he is and whether he's maybe partaking in a bit too much plastic surgery before the Sochi meeting.
What about what do you feel, Stepan, about reports that, I mean, he looks very, very ill very often, and we've seen these kind of strange pictures where, you know, his hand is shaking and he seems unable to stop twitching. Facially, he looks very bloated. He doesn't look at all well. And people say he may have some kind of cancer. I mean, do you feel that he's sick? I do.
Well, if wishing made it so, it would be great. Certainly, he's of a certain age. It's expected that people in that age gap develop certain illnesses. For years, we've had talk of him having Asperger's and various other illnesses. Cancer is the most recent one. In the meeting that he had before in Iran, there were reports of people carrying briefcases with his, let's be honest, excrement that allegedly his security detail was collecting, so no one could find out about his health conditions. He's a secretive man. Most certainly he has problems, whether they're fatal or whether we should expect that the world will shake off his evil reaches soon. Unfortunately, nobody knows, but hopefully that does happen.
I mean, I don't know if you've met him personally, but from reports we read, what's he like as a person? I mean, is he good company or is he... I mean, he looks very taciturn, but in private, what's he like?
I haven't met him personally, whether fortunately or unfortunately, but... of course, we have the very famous remark of George Bush, who looked him in the eyes. But other than that, everyone who meets him seems to come out with the same line, that he is the person you want, you expect him to be. That is, he adapts his appearance, his attitude to the person he talks to. He wants to become friends to get something out of you. After all, he's a KGB agent. That is what they're trained to do. They're trained to get information, trained to get their way. He hasn't lost that. So perhaps we shouldn't look too much into how people perceive him in their private meetings. But at the actions of his actions. And his actions are not of one who is trustworthy, not of one who should be believed in any case.
I mean, in fairness to him, I think what you want me to be, I'll be whatever you want to be, is a trait you find in many world leaders. Everybody always said, both of Bill Clinton and Tony Blair, that nobody ever left a room or a meeting with them without feeling that they agreed with every word that they said, and then they found out that wasn't the case.
Well, that is true, I think, not just for Bill Clinton and Blair, but for all politicians. After all, they have... They're in the game of winning, and they need people to like them. Mm. I wouldn't put Tony Blair and Bill Clinton in the same group as Putin, though.
No, that trait, that chameleon-like quality to be all things to all men, I think is pretty useful for a world leader. To make this conversation slightly more general, in terms of the Ukrainian war, what will Putin settle for? What would he consider to be a situation that he could bow out with dignity and say, I've achieved what I need? He's not stupid. He will accept there's going to be some compromise down the way. What is he after, do you think?
Well, I think from the start, he made it clear that what he's after is the entirety of Ukraine. It's becoming more and more obvious that that is impossible. They're trying all they can to get a land bridge between Russia, Crimea, and the Russian forces in Moldova. The Ukrainian army is preventing that. They're gearing up for a push in the south of the country, and hopefully they will drive out the Russians from the Kherson region, which borders Crimea. In terms of Putin's end goal at the moment, it is entirely possible that he would want to cut his losses at the current gains. But I don't think the Ukrainians are quite happy with that, and I don't think everyone else is. Mm. It's not the 17th century or the 10th century or the Stone Age. We can't just declare war because we'd like a bit of land. Mm-hmm. And he needs to understand this. More than that, this would set a very dangerous precedent for his friends in Iran, for his friends in Syria. And this kind of behavior has to be countered. Now, hopefully, with the new arms that the US announced today or yesterday, that will go some way towards that. Mm-hmm. Britain, of course, has been a big supporter of Ukraine, both in the media and people of Britain, and financially and militarily. Now, this has to carry on. The only hope the Ukrainians have against the overwhelmingly larger Russian army is weaponry that Russians can't access. There's been a report recently that due to the computer chip shortage, Russians are having severe difficulties in manufacturing their long-range rockets. Now, those have caused some trouble for Ukrainians in their supply lines, especially with Western weapons. But now that they can't make them, they have a very limited supply. And the longer the range weapons that we can provide, the more calamitous they are to the Russian army, the better.
Look, very quick question, Stepan, because I've really got to go. But I was wondering how much Putin's body double might get paid, but I'm sure you wouldn't know that. Fascinating issue, though, it is. One word answer. In terms of this war, would it be a good thing or a bad thing if Putin died from ill health?
Well, I think using a body double shows that he has worries. And whether it's ill health or personal security, in any case, it is beneficial for all of us. But I don't think that if he was to die today, there would be a drastic change, because the population of Russia has been propagandized heavily and they need time to adjust to a normal state.
I get it. That wasn't a one-word answer, by the way, but it was a very good answer. And it was good to talk to you. Thank you very much, Stepan Stepanenko, there, research fellow at the Henry Jackson Society.